Soul Calibur. It has been way too long since covering Soul Blade to not have covered its sequel by now. I had not played Soul Calibur in over 20 years before doing so for this video, except for a couple games at an arcade a few years back. That's because I never owned it myself. My aunt's then boyfriend left his copy at my grandmother's for a few weeks, and in that time I played so much of it on her Dreamcast. And then not long after my grandmother let me have that Dreamcast for myself, it broke down, with me taking over a decade to buy a new one, with recording this game for the channel being the main reason. Then it took another 2.5 years to finally play the thing. To explain the plot, I first have to explain how Soul Blade ended. Cervantes, the host of the evil Soul Edge, was defeated by Sofitia Alexandra and Taki, the former destroying one of Soul Edge's blades, and the latter killing him. Once they left, Siegfried Stauffen arrived to see Soul Edge reanimate Cervantes' corpse and take control. Siegfried manages to come out on top and claims Soul Edge for himself. However, it is too powerful for him and takes him over. A massive column of light shoots from Soul Edge into the sky, the Evil Seed. The Evil Seed would be known as the sign that death and destruction is near. Siegfried, now Soul Edge's newest host, is transformed into the Azure Knight, Nightmare. Nightmare then terrorizes Europe, slaughtering many with his followers to power Soul Edge with his victim souls. It's now 3 years later, and many warriors have since set off on their journeys to defeat Nightmare and either destroy Soul Edge or claim it for themselves. So, for the gameplay. The main methods of attack from Soul Blade return: horizontal attack, vertical attack, kick, block button which can be used to guard impact, pairs of buttons for throws and unblockable strong attacks. What was removed from Soul Blade was the critical edge, and by extension the weapon gauge and losing your weapon. I never cared for either of these, and the unarmed style was boring, so I'm not sad to see it go. In fact, as a kid, it never occurred to me that it was gone. The feature was so unnecessary and unmemorable. The game's biggest addition is the 8-way run. Soul Blade had some basic sidestepping, but now you can freely walk around the stage in the direction you hold the stick. As fun as I feel Soul Blade still is, I currently have it ranked number 5 out of 185 for a reason. Soul Calibur is just on another level. It keeps what worked, cut what didn't, and made it all faster and more responsive. But now we're done with the gameplay, let's look at these characters. We start with 10 like in the first game, 4 or 5 returning, and 6 or 5 newcomers depending on how you look at one of them. I'll start with our new trio of main heroes, beginning with the game's poster boy, Killik. Killik was raised in the Ling Shengsu Temple, which held 3 sacred treasures: the staff Kali Yuga, the mirror Dithapara Yuga, and the third treasure, stolen around 17 years prior, the sword Krita Yuga. Killik's older sister figure, Shang Lian, whose father had stolen the Krita Yuga, had been chosen to inherit the Dithapara Yuga, while Killik became the inheritor of Kali Yuga. However, once the evil seed affected their temple, it caused all of the monks to lose their minds and become feral, turning on and killing each other. The only one unaffected was Shang Lian, due to the Dithapara Yuga's power. To save Killik, she put the Dithapara Yuga on him to restore his sanity. However, the rest of the monks were still affected, and now Shang Liang was among them. In the end, Killik had to kill them all in self-defense. Killik woke up the next morning, found by an old man, Edgemaster. Edgemaster took Killik in and trained him. He explained that both Killik and Kali Yuga have been infected by the evil seed, and only the Dithapara Yuga is keeping him sane. He learns that Soul Edge is the source of his infection, and once his training is done, he sets off on a quest to purify his soul. Fighting with a staff, Killik has a lot of range, allowing you to fight well without having to get in very close. His attacks are also fast as well, leaving him with very few flaws and perfect as a character for beginners. He also has quite the selection of kicks to use. Killik is insanely fun, just one of the most fun characters in the game for me, probably across the entire series if we're just talking about this game's version. He's just got so much good stuff to use, and it all looks so stylish and cool. When I was a kid, I tended to gravitate towards larger characters in 3D fighting games. But discovering Killik in this game really taught me the value of speedier characters and how much more I tend to enjoy them. Because I fell so far behind on the Soul Calibur games after 2, I never quite had the chance to really get into Killik's story. In fact, I never got too into the stories of most of the post-Soul Blade characters. I know the broad strokes, but for this channel I'll be looking into the details for the first time. He's got a decent setup to his story, but most of Killik's character comes from his interactions with certain other characters who I haven't talked about yet. So I'm sure I'll have more opinions by the next game once I catch myself up with how everything fits. His default outfit is a classic. A shirtless guy isn't always the most interesting design, but the Dithapara Yuga slung over his shoulder is very striking and elevates the outfit. Every character has a second costume, and it's weird. The second costume has more going on with the vest and the fur collar, but I still prefer his first outfit. I think it's the colours. The bright red just seems to fit Killik better than the yellow and blue. His stage, the Proving Grounds, looks very nice. The small arena surrounded by clear water and what I assume is Edgemaster's hut in the background. But the main point of interest is the new legend, his theme. It's one of my favourite tracks in the game. Soul Calibur goes for a more grand and epic style than Soul Blade for its music for the rest of the series. But even to this day, the Soul Blade soundtrack is the one I find the most memorable, and this track is the one that feels closest to the style of Soul Blade. Next up, we have the second part of our new main trio, Chai Shanghua. Shanghua's mother, Shang Fei, was one of the most skilled students of the Ling Sheng Su Temple. She began a secret relationship with one of the temple monks, Kong Xiu Chang, something forbidden by the temple's rules. Said relationship was outed by the birth of their daughter, Shang Liang. Shang Liang was taken from her parents as a toddler and raised by the temple themselves, something that left Shang Fei too grief-stricken to remain at the temple. A mutual friend tried to convince the two to leave the temple so that they can stay together and raise a family without the interference of the temple. Shang Fei wanted this, but Xiu Chang refused. Shang Fei would leave the temple, with Xiu Chang sneaking her the Krita Yuga, the sword acting as a promise that he would see her again. What he didn't know was that when Shang Fei left, she was already pregnant with their second daughter. Shang Fei returned to China and became a soldier in the Ming Dynasty Imperial Guard, giving birth to Shanghua soon after, but never telling her of her father. Xiu Chang would be exiled by the temple once his theft of one of their sacred treasures was known. He would manage to track down Shang Fei, but the Chai family asked him to leave her alone, as they believed she would be happier in her new life in the belief that Xiu Chang was still training at the temple. After he left, monks from the temple also showed up looking to find their treasure. They left empty-handed, not knowing that the sword the child Shanghua was training with was the Krita Yuga in disguise. As she grew, Shanghua would also become a member of the Imperial Guard. The Ming Emperor at this point was getting frustrated by the failure to retrieve Soul Edge, believed by him to be the hero sword, from everyone he sent out to find it. Everyone he sent out, including Li Long, never returned. He decided to speed the quest up by sending out a group of his guard, posing as a travelling opera group with Shanghua as a main attraction. At this point in her life, Shang Fei had passed away, her dying words to Shanghua being that she was born to complete an important task. Shanghua would abandon the guard and set off alone, with the Krita Yuga her mother passed down to her, unaware of what it was. During her journey, she would meet Killik and the Japanese pirate Maxi. Once Killik told her of how evil the sword she was looking for was, she agreed to help both of them destroy it. Shanghua fights with a Chinese sword, a Xian. What she lacks in damage and range, she makes up with in pure speed. Along with this, her moveset even includes a few feints, dodging away from the opponent even mid-combo. I never put much effort into Shanghua before, only playing as her to unlock her arcade endings, but since I had to pay attention for the video, I realised I found her quite fun. All those spinning slashes when they land and the way she swings a sword for those vertical attacks mean that even if you're mashing the controller with your face, you can still pull off something that looks good. Shanghua was a character I was never very invested in. Nothing wrong with her, I just wasn't. However, there are still things I like about her, such as how despite Killik getting the most attention in the promotional materials, Shanghua is the actual main character of the game, as we'll see when I get to talk about the final boss. And unlike Mitsurugi in Soul Blade, who didn't do anything important, she's the one who canonically wins at the end. It's a last minute twist that I like. I should also bring up her relationship with Killik, since it was pretty much the main romance of the series. Right now it's barely started, but it is in the interesting phase where Shanghua doesn't know that Killik killed her sister, even if it was self-defense. Although at this point I'm not even sure if Shanghua knows she has a sister. This romance will be concluded in a way that tried to be both tragic and please those invested in it, and I don't think it fully worked in the end. For one thing, it made Killik look like a gigantic asshole, but we'll get to that should I ever reach Soul Calibur 5. Shanghua's default outfit is perfectly fine. It's not her best, not her worst. I think those shoulder pads add a lot to it by making her silhouette a little more interesting. Her second costume is okay, but I prefer the first in this case. I prefer the first costume's hairstyle and think the blue stood out more on her than the red. Her stage is the Emperor's Garden, a platform surrounded by water with a temple in the background. I think it's one of the nicest looking stages in the game. Let's finish off the main trio by looking at another newcomer, Maxi. As a child, his father was a wandering merchant from the Ryukyu Kingdom, and Maxi would spend his childhood travelling with him. Frustrated that they could never see beyond Japan, due to the laws preventing his father from dealing with foreign countries. He taught himself to fight with nunchaku, which led to an incident on one of his travels where he met a man from China calling himself Chang Wu, in reality an alias of Li Long. Maxi challenged Long to a fight and was easily defeated. Maxi begged Long to teach him for the rest of the journey and Long agreed, teaching Maxi his skills until he left at the next port. After Maxi's father died and Maxi inherited his ship, he decided not to continue as a merchant bound to Japan, but to become a pirate so that he could see the world. He set off with his crew and his sworn brother, Kiam. While Maxi was away from the ship at an Indian port, Killick approached the ship, hoping to catch a ride west. Since Kiam sympathised with Killick's story, he allowed him to stay until Maxi returned to make the final decision. But when Maxi did return, he found his ship under attack from a horde led by the Golem Astaroth and most of his crew slaughtered. Maxi and Killick fought together to repel the monsters, but Astaroth managed to remove the Dithapara Yuga from Killick, causing him to lose his sanity again and attack Maxi. Maxi managed to both fight off Killick and regain Dithapara Yuga from Astaroth to return Killick to his senses. Once Astaroth had fled, Maxi found that most of his crew were dead and missing, and Kiam was dying. Kiam used his dying words to tell Killick's story to Maxi. Maxi swears revenge on Astaroth and joins Killick and then later, Shangwa. There are many characters designed to be successors of characters from Soul Blade. However, all of the originals would also return, with Li Long as the only exception, making Maxi the only full replacement on the roster. Since he was taught by Li Long, he shares a lot of his Soul Blade moveset and just adds more to it. I already praised Li Long's moveset in that game for being so fun, and this moveset returns in a more fun game, so I enjoy it even more. As a character, I like Maxi, but, and I know I'm in the minority on this, I've always liked Li Long more. It's that more grounded, more morally ambiguous side of Soul Blade that mostly disappeared in the transition to this game. In terms of story, he's kind of the third wheel to Killick and Shangwa too, with them having the more interesting stuff to do. If they're not going to have Li Long with his own moveset again in a future game, I would be totally fine with Maxi sitting out one to give Long another chance at being the sole nunchaku wielder. Speaking of Long, you know how his bad ending in Soul Blade revealed that his lover was pregnant? At 9, I assumed Maxi was Li Long's son from that ending. The fact that would mean he'd aged 20 years while everyone else was barely any older never occurred to me. His first costume is a classic and a version of this will stick with him through every game. I don't know who decided our Bruce Lee clone must also be Elvis with that hair, but it somehow works for him. The alternate, I'm just not feeling. The blonde hair with that style plus the yellow top and green trousers makes him look a bit too much like Charlie from Street Fighter to me, and it's distracting. His stage is the Indian port where he met Killick and lost his crew to Astaroth, with his ship in the background. It's suitably depressing, looking lifeless with the rain, and I always like when a character's stage has a story tied to them. Moving on, let's check out a returning character next with Sophitia Alexandra. During Soul Blade, Sophitia made it to Cervantes and during the fight she managed to destroy one of Soul Edge's blades. However, its destruction caused several shards to fly out, embedding in her body and leaving her unable to fight, forcing Taki to save her and kill Cervantes. Taki would carry the wounded Sophitia home, with only her sister Cassandra believing her story. Sophitia would eventually recover from her wounds and go back to her life as a baker's daughter. One day, while out shopping, she suddenly had a vision of Nightmare and recognised the sword he was carrying to be Soul Edge. The vision made her collapse, but she was helped out by a swordsmith, Rothian. The two began a relationship and eventually got engaged. When visiting Hephaestus' temple to report their engagement, the god gave her another mission, destroy the remains of Soul Edge. Hephaestus gave holy metal to Rothian and instructed him to make Sophitia a new sword and shield to wield on her quest. Being the first returning character I'm talking about, Sophitia is the first character I'm looking at whose moveset is her Soul Blade moveset, but more. The recognisable moves are still there, the impaling the gut, the apologetic knee to the balls, the crotch in the face froze. The game's new speed really benefits Sophitia, and this is one of her most fun playable forms for me, maybe even the most fun. Story-wise, she doesn't have much to do here. She's doing a repeat of her quest from the first game, only canonically she doesn't accomplish anything. But what Sophitia gained in this game was a look into her home life. Her sister Cassandra was mentioned as existing in Soul Blade, even if they localised her name wrong, but that was it. Here she has a minor role just being part of Sophitia's daily life. The other new addition is her fiancé and later husband, Rothian. And holy shit, I do not get the sheer level of hatred this inoffensive minor character who rarely even makes physical appearances gets. I mean, I know why, but I don't get feeling that way. The first is the simplest, shipping. It seems from what I've seen, the popular alternative is Siegfried. There are always people who get disproportionately bent out of shape over shipping, no surprise there. There's a subset of that who hate that Sophitia's husband is a background character who doesn't fight himself. This I highly disagree with. I like it when a character is fleshed out with family members at home to show that these people have a life outside of the plots of the games. And Rothian still at least contributes to Sophitia's stories by being the person forging her weapons. I always hate it that whenever we learn of a relative to a character on a fighting game roster, we always get demands to make that character playable. Rothian would add nothing being forced onto the roster as a playable character and taking up room. We don't need Liu Kang's estranged brother just because his name was on a comic page. So much of Heihachi's family has been made playable that we're at serious risk of his proctologist being added to the roster. Then of course there are some people who take issue that the man of the relationship, someone not trained to fight as far as we know, not doing the fighting for his wife, a Greek god's chosen warrior. I don't even feel the need to dignify that one. Plus of course there's the people who want their fictional waifu to stay single and available or it will invalidate their fantasies. As someone whose favourite character is Sophitia, I really don't get that way of thinking. I like that Sophitia is not this person who only exists during the main plot with no personal connections. I like that while the games are happening, there's a husband and an evolving family life throughout the games waiting for her. Yes, it comes back to bite us much later, but that's the fault of Soul Calibur V, not Ruffian himself. Sophitia's default costume is less armoured than her original, but I like it more. The blue top stands out more than the brown armour she used to have, and I find the boots look better than the wraps she had on her legs. One of Sophitia's better costumes to me. Her alternate is one I'm not sure about. I like the torso piece and the overall idea and shape of it, but the purple just looks wrong to me on Sophitia. I think it would look a lot better in her usual blue and white. Her stage is another take on the Shrine of Eurydice, taking place on this platform in the air. What I really like about this stage is that in the background you can see a mountain and some steps to the top where the Soul Blade version of the shrine can be seen. I like little bits of continuity like that. Taki next. Taki arrived at the scene of the fight between Sophitia and Cervantes just as Sophitia had been weakened by the shards of Soul Edge. So Taki took over, her sealing spells ineffective and her weakening sword Rekimaru having lost almost all power. Despite this, she still managed to kill Cervantes and carry Sophitia away. Not long after leaving the area, she got to witness the evil seed's release from a distance. She removed the shards of Soul Edge from Sophitia's body and dropped her off back home. Hoping that the destruction of one of Soul Edge's blades would return Rekimaru to full strength and return her possessed master Toki to normal, Taki returned home. However, Toki was still possessed and had his assassins attack Taki. She learns that Toki is aware of the location of Mekimaru, the sword that once belonged to Toki but was stolen by Hachibe, the father of Linlong's lover Chie. Taki had it hidden away to prevent the possessed Toki from finding it. She retrieved Mekimaru from where she hid it and turned her attention to the drained Rekimaru. She tried to fuse a shard of soul that she'd removed from Sophitia into it, but it didn't work. She tried the same process on Mekimaru, which worked. The fused sword released a dark aura so strong that even normal people were able to sense it. Attempts to seal it didn't work, and so Taki runs away from the Fuma clan to find the new wielder of Soul Edge in the hopes that in the resulting fight, the two evil swords would destroy each other. Despite this goal, she does feel a temptation to keep this new sword and master its power. Like Sophitia, Taki is her Soul Blade self, but more. The quick and unpredictable moves with very short range, all the fancy flips and kicks, the out of character high-pitched scream with the running stab. She gains a lot of moves done in the air that would probably have looked awkward back in Soul Blade's slower gameplay. I know I've said it for everyone so far, but she's just a lot of fun too, easy to use and do well with. I don't have too much to say about her story. I keep forgetting that there's this whole off-screen side plot of ninja politics that also plays a big part of Linlong's story as well. Her first costume is good, but it's just a downgraded version of the Soul Blade costume to me. The dark purple doesn't suit her as much as the red, and the removed sleeves and armour makes it less cool as well. And the armoured mask she used to have stood out so much more than the generic cloth mask that's the same colour as her bodysuit. Her second costume is a better take on an unmasked costume than her second costume in Soul Blade was. I like the armour, but even downgraded from before, I prefer her first costume. Her stage is the Hoko Temple. It's a pretty cool one with a huge statue in the back. Looking at its story though, I don't see what the connection to Taki is. That's the first half of the default roster down. Let's check in on the previous game's main character, Heishiro Mitsurugi. Despite being the main character of Soul Blade, Mitsurugi didn't accomplish anything. He was unable to track down Soul Edge, the sword that would keep him relevant in a world where firearms were gaining popularity. Frustrated at making no progress, he challenged a rifle gunman to a duel in front of his lord and suffered a humiliating defeat that left him scarred. He left in shame to begin a second journey to perfect his sword skills. That was when he heard of Nightmare rampaging through Europe with his unstoppable sword. Mitsurugi sets off to track him down and obtain that sword for himself. Mitsurugi retains some of his Soul Blade moves, but he's been more overhauled than the previous two returnees have been. He gains some new stances he can use to get out even more attacks with. There's one where he rears his sword back with both hands and one where he sheaves his sword. This Mitsurugi is so much more enjoyable than his Soul Blade original thanks to these stances. They give you so much more to work with. When it comes to his story, I really don't have much to say. This is going to be it for the next few games, Nightmare Stalker. This would also be the start of his rivalry with Taki, who will do her best to steer him away from Soul Edge whenever he gets near. The armoured second costume he had in Soul Blade becomes the basis of his default costume here, and it looks so much better. The shoulder panning and the sash by his waist make it so much more memorable than that one. His second costume is pretty good too. Keeping it mostly white and black combined with him leaving one of the sleeves empty makes it look so stylish when it starts flapping from all the movement. I also prefer this hairstyle over the slicked back look. His stage is the real-life Takamatsu Castle and takes place during a real-life siege, in which Mitsurugi was charged with the castle's defence, which is why we can see arrows flying around. We fight on the wooden raft Mitsurugi rode during the battle after the castle was flooded. It's fine, but we have better stages with castles and temples in the back. But it does have some great music. A case where, when comparing a Soul Blade character's theme to their Soul Calibur equivalent, this comes out on top. While I'm on Mitsurugi, I may as well talk about Arthur too. Like how Huang was created as a model swap of Mitsurugi for Korean audiences back when heroic depictions of samurai were taboo, they had to do the same once again for this game. And since Huang had already been made his own character by now, they couldn't do it with him again and they needed to create a new character. This one they put a bit less effort into, as all they did was make Mitsurugi blonde and give him an eye patch and a new story as being English from Southampton. He's clearly inspired by William Adams, the first Western samurai. He does have a lot of his own backstory, but since I have no footage to use over it with, I'll save it all for the one game in which he exists as his own character. I do wish he could be accessed on the Dreamcast though. Even if it's just a change in hair colour, I would have played for arcade mode again as him. Moving on to another newcomer, we have Ivy. Ivy was the daughter of the noble Valentine family. But then her father, Earl Valentine, got into alchemy and became obsessed with discovering the key to eternal youth. His pursuit of this goal drained the family's fortune, and by the time he was dead, the Valentines had nothing. Not wanting to live as a poor person, his wife, Countess Valentine, decided to stop living. Well, that and the grief at her husband's death destroying her health. Either way, Ivy was left alone. But her mother did leave Ivy something in her will, the fact that she was adopted. The Valentines found Ivy at their mansion door when she was a baby and took her in. Ivy wasn't actually that bothered about that knowledge, as the Valentines were the only parents she knew, and that was what mattered to her. I mean, how interesting could her real parentage be? While looking through her parents' stuff, she found her father's diary. Turns out the key to eternal youth is actually Soul Edge. Ivy decided to become an alchemist herself and started looking into Soul Edge. She also looked into the people who'd last owned it, Cervantes, Rock's father, Verchi. She realised that the sword that drove her father mad and ruined her family was evil all along, and vowed to use her alchemical skills to create a weapon that could destroy Soul Edge. She built herself a whip sword, but couldn't find a way to make it powerful enough to take on Soul Edge. So she turned to sorcery instead, trying to summon a creature that could grant her weapon the power it needs. After several failures and becoming angrier and angrier, she eventually called forth a huge monstrous arm through the summoning circle. Said arm sensed her attachment to the weapon and granted it the power she wanted. She now had a living weapon that moved to her commands. With this in her possession, she could finally search for Soul Edge. Ivy is the expert character of the game. She has the basic sword swings, but relying on that isn't using her to her full potential. You have to master transforming the blade into a whip. The default blade is fine for fighting up close, but when in whip form, you can fight from even further away. I tried, and I even pulled off some cool stuff, but the level of technical skill you need for Ivy isn't for me. She's still enjoyable even when you aren't very good, but I wasn't able to get as much out of her as I could other characters. In choosing to ignore everything I already knew about Ivy and starting from here, Ivy's portrayal is quite interesting. She's presented like a villain in a lot of the official artwork, and they give her the domineering personality in battle and in a moveset which is common to villains. And yet she isn't. Hell, she's probably a morally better person than series mascot Mitsurugi. She doesn't want the sword, she wants to destroy it because it destroyed her family. And yet, the power granted to the weapon she intends to destroy Soul Edge with was granted to her by the wielder of Soul Edge itself, and she will get conned into helping it out. I like Ivy, but she's not a favourite. Now for her default outfit. Ivy has some variation of this outfit through most of her appearances, and it is one of the series' most iconic. I think this is one of the better versions of it, but not my favourite. As I've said before in a couple other videos, I don't have a problem with sexualised outfits like Ivy's in general, like this one. But later games, in an attempt to try and make it more sexy, will take things to a point where it just looks silly. This strikes a good balance. Her second outfit remembers that she's nobility. She has a couple outfits of this theme throughout the series, and I think this one looks far better than the other attempt at one. This one suits her quite well. Her stage is the Valentine Mansion. It is certainly a mansion. It's okay, but I feel it's far overshadowed by a lot of the outdoor stages we've seen so far. Let's check out our final returning character of the default 10 with Voldo. His search for Soul Edge ended in failure, and he returned to the money pit of his late master, Verchi, to find it had flooded while he was away. Voldo saved what he could and went back to hiding away inside the vault. 3 years later, Ivy enters the money pit trying to find a lead on Soul Edge, knowing that Verchi once owned it. Voldo chases her away but notices that she also had the scent of Soul Edge on her. Vecchi's voice starts ringing in his head again, telling him to track that woman down and come back with Soul Edge this time. Voldo is the same tricky stance-changing character he was in Soul Blade, and almost all of his attacks return and they give him even more weird stuff, like his multi-directional pelvic thrusting, jumping only to flop on the floor like a fish. Probably his most iconic addition is his Mantis Crawl, which I never managed to pull off myself. For such an expert character, I'm surprised how well I did as him. He's never a character I play as, so it's unexpected when I do well. I'm still ambivalent towards the character though. His quests of Vecchi just don't interest me at all. His default outfit is a new take on his original. He loses the fishnets and it becomes red instead of blue. He also swaps out his sleeves for armour and his chin piece is no longer pointy. It's a good costume and the rail on him is striking, but I just prefer the little details on the Slow Blade version. His alternate goes for a more jester look, which is a fine idea, but I don't care for the brown they used on it. It makes it blander than it could have been. His stage is the Money Pit, his stage from Soul Blade, but as I said earlier, it was flooded while Voldo was away. Now the main platform is surrounded by water, and the only notable part is the statue of Vecchi in the background. It does a good job showing Voldo's dedication though, that he'll stay alone in this place even when it's in this state. Now for another new character with Astaroth. Astaroth is a golem created by Kunpetku, the grand priest to the god of destruction, Ares. Ares desired Soul Edge and sent Kunpetku to search for it, and so Kunpetku created Astaroth to do it for him. After sending him out, Kunpetku realised that should Astaroth return with Soul Edge, he could keep it and become a god himself. Astaroth does find Soul Edge in the hands of Nightmare, but seeing how the destruction of one of its blades has made it only half as powerful as it once was, Astaroth agrees to work for Nightmare by aiding in his slaughtering to collect souls to power it. Once Soul Edge is completed, Astaroth plans to snatch it for himself and bring it back to his creator. Astaroth wields an axe, and is taking Rock's place as the new main biggest guy and grappler. He has many of Rock's moves from Soul Blade, although not quite as powerful as in that game to make up for the game's faster speed. He's still quite fun despite being one of the game's slowest characters, as even this game's slowest character still feels a little speedy. I enjoyed Rock's moveset in Soul Blade, and so of course I would enjoy it more in a more enjoyable game. As for Astaroth himself, as a kid when I first played this, Astaroth was one of my favourite newcomers. I thought he was so cool and much better than Rock. But as I got older, I found that to wear off and I don't really find the character cool anymore. He's a bit tryhard to my taste now, and him being a mostly mindless golem who just screams death threats doesn't make for an engaging character to me now. Nowadays, I much prefer Rock and wish he hadn't been booted from the series in favour of Astaroth. I don't dislike him, he's fine. But today he's probably my least favourite newcomer from this game. Everything I said also applies to his default outfit. I used to find it really cool with the exposed heart, but nowadays I find it quite bland, like a discount Mortal Kombat 2 Shao Kahn. His alternate costume I would prefer. I like the purple skin tone and the spikes coming out of his back, but there's one big problem. That stupid jiggly hair spike on top of his head. It looks so ridiculous and drags down the entire outfit. Chop that shit off and it would be the better costume. His stage is the Palgaia Shrine where Astaroth was created. The dark atmosphere and lava instead of water is certainly fitting for a character as extreme as Astaroth. With the other default 9 looked at, that just leaves our main antagonist, Nightmare. Siegfried arrived to find the dead Cervantes killed by Taki and got to see his body get taken over by Soul Edge and transform. Siegfried was the victor in that fight and then his bad ending from Soul Blade happened. He claimed Soul Edge for himself, but he took possession of his body and twisted it into the Azure Knight with the malformed arm. Soul Edge itself also transformed its shape to fit its new host. Since losing one of its blades in the fight with Sophitia, Soul Edge needed to consume human souls to return to its full strength. It got into Siegfried's head and lied to him that if he gathered the souls it needed, it would resurrect his father, Frederick, who Siegfried had accidentally killed and convinced himself into thinking was murdered by someone else. And so Nightmare became an unstoppable force of nature, travelling Europe and wiping out all he ran into to feed their souls into Soul Edge. Along the way, he even manages to get help by convincing Astaroth to help him gather souls, and even tricks Ivy into doing some of the work for him. With Siegfried being the host body, Nightmare inherits a lot of his moveset from the previous game. Like Astaroth, he's slow but powerful, yet some of his attacks can be deceptively fast. He also gains a couple stance changes, such as holding his sword over his shoulder against his back, or lowered near the ground with one hand. This game's moveset is one of the most enjoyable versions in the entire series to me. I don't quite remember ever doing as well with Nightmare in any later game. He feels like a total beast here, just getting in and flailing this massive sword around and just wiping out everything around him. Nightmare was like Astaroth to me as a kid, but he was actually my favourite newcomer back then. Unlike Astaroth, that never really wore off as I got older. Nightmare still manages to be cool and appealing to me now. When did they get his design right anyway? It's no wonder Nightmare became a second series mascot with Misurugi and became the logo for Project Soul. Discovering that the bad ending that creeped me out as a child was actually the canon one, and discovering that was Siegfried in there was quite a memorable reveal to me. I hadn't unlocked many other characters, and so it seemed at first that the four default returnees were all who came back, so I wasn't looking for any of the other six. His first costume is one of his better ones, but not my favourite. It's got that armour, it's got that gross massive arm. Later games have tried to make Nightmare look more monstrous, but I find he looks best when they try to keep the armour simple. The amount of body the mutated arm takes up is also important. Too much and it doesn't work for me. I should also bring up the new design for Soul Edge, which has become far more iconic than the original, shorter red version. The eye on the blade surrounded by fleshy matter in the middle is an especially good addition to really sell that the sword is alive and has a will of its own. The second costume is a good one, having him shirtless to show how far the mutation goes along his skin. The only part I'm not a big fan of is the new helmet. A bit too long at the front and shows too much face. His stage is Ostreinsburg Castle. In Soul Blade, this stage saw constant battle in the background. But since its master was killed, his remaining soldiers were executed and civilians taken as slaves, the castle lies in ruins, totally lifeless. While that had nothing to do with Nightmare's actions, it works to show just how different Siegfried's life is now than in the previous game. Those are the default 10 characters, but there are more to unlock. First I have to clear Arcade mode with this lot. Arcade has 8 stages, and on the 7th stage you battle your character's rival. They don't do too much with this, the two say a line each before the fight. Some of them are actual unique dialogue, while others are just generic. Defeating your rival reveals the final boss. It's Soul Edge once again, taking a fiery form, now properly known as Inferno. If you're playing as Shanghua, the Krita Yuga will then transform into Soul Calibur and become Shanghua's weapon for this fight. Inferno will always start round 1 wielding Soul Edge, and will then swap weapons on each subsequent round. I'll talk more about Inferno in the next video. For now, let's defeat it and see those endings. Killick defeats Inferno, but Soul Edge makes one last attempt to shatter the world. Killick performs a chant that makes either the power Yuga split apart and put Soul Edge down. Having learned to control the evil within himself from the evil seed, Killick then undergoes further training. Shanghua's ending shows Krita Yuga transforming into Soul Calibur once again, using the sword to cut down Inferno. The clouds part and sun shines through as Shanghua realises that this must be the important task her mother told her she was born to complete. Just like Li Long before him, Maxi collapses during his victory animation after defeating Inferno. The final battle had left Maxi mortally wounded, dying in Killick's arms. Killick and Shanghua then leave on Maxi's ship, neither of them having any words for what just happened. Considering Li Long's bad ending and then this one, I thought this would be a trend in the series going forward. Each game would get a new nunchaku wielder who would die and be replaced with the next one, like the equivalent to Jack from Tekken. Once again completing a task from Hephaestus, Sophitia returns home. Sophitia and Rothian are finally married, and soon after Sophitia gives birth to her first child, this one being her daughter Pyrrha, so not the one that ruined everything. Sophitia wonders if, since she can no longer hear the voices of the gods, maybe her children can. Don't give them ideas. Taki cuts down Inferno with Mekimaru. Despite the destruction of Inferno and Soul Edge, the evil inside Mekimaru remains. Taki decides to just carry on, confirming her kill with her catchphrase. Mitsurugi finally obtains Soul Edge. 3 years is all it takes to change his mind on wielding evil weapons, and he keeps it this time instead of destroying it. While at sea, he gets attacked by pirates. When they surround him with guns, he gets excited about being able to try out his new weapon. That would be the last time Mitsurugi was heard from. Ivy is shaken to find that, although she can kill Inferno, she cannot destroy Soul Edge itself. That is due to her cursed blood, as her biological father is Cervantes. Despite learning this, Ivy comes to terms with it very easily, actually feeling as if a burden has been lifted on her soul. She manages to break the curse on her blood and begins a new quest. Voldo grabs Soul Edge and ends up in unbearable pain. A voice tells him to entrust his soul to the sword, and in doing so, the pain ended, his memories return, and he was granted his youth and, most importantly, his full head of hair. He is granted an image of Verchi and realises that he has finally fulfilled his master's wish. Despite his regained youth, he once again stays hidden away in the money pit, content. Astaroth returns to his creator Kunpetku with Soul Edge. Kunpetku is thrilled to be able to gain the power of the gods, but doesn't expect to be lifted from behind by Astaroth. Astaroth desires more souls for Soul Edge, and so he walks into a huge flame carrying Kunpetku, burning the two of them to nothing. Astaroth's intentions here are never revealed, and we are told that it is impossible to know. Having finally obtained enough souls, Soul Edge transforms into the image of Siegfried's father, Frederick. Frederick has Siegfried run him through with a sword. This is to get through to Siegfried that Frederick is an illusion, and he asks his son to reflect on the sins he has committed and repent. Free of Soul Edge and Bacchus himself, Siegfried stands over his father's grave and wonders if it's even possible to redeem himself after everything he has done as Nightmare. But he still sets off on a new journey to try. As for my rewards for completing Arcade Mode, doing so with one character unlocks Hwang Song-yong. Hwang's search for Soul Edge had to be cut short when he heard of an impending invasion of Korea from Japan. He returned home, also dragging Song-mina home to her father and his master, Song Han-myong. Hwang then returned to the Coast Guard but learned that Song-mina had run away from home again. Hwang got pretty angry at learning this and failed to focus on his current task, getting many of his crew killed and himself dismissed after leading them into a pirate's trap. Hwang is instead given the task of helping Han-myong find Mina under the cover story of searching for Soul Edge. Hwang has had a bit of an overhaul. He still retains his unique moves from Soul Blade, and some of the moves he shared with Mitsurugi that Mitsurugi lost, but the rest of his moveset is filled in with moves from Shanghua. Hwang is still one of the most fun characters in the game for me. His unique stuff is still fun and I can never get enough of those kicks. They kept a good selection of Mitsurugi's old moves and the Shanghua moves they gave him fit him very well. Probably the most fun character in the game for me. Which is why I'm sad to say that this is kind of the beginning of the end for Hwang for a long while. While he will still make the odd appearance, after this game they are going to keep trying to replace him. It should be no surprise that none of Hwang's replacements match up to me. Should the series continue after Soul Calibur 6, I hope Hwang's return in that game sticks and the people at Project Soul realise that he's too good a character to just abandon again like they did before. I will say that there isn't much to his story in this game though, kind of a repeat of his story from the first game with him looking for Mina. His first costume is okay, but I feel this game has his weakest selection of costumes overall. The green, the headband and the little scarf on the back are fine, but I'm not sure about the midriff. The second costume is weaker. The green trousers I like, but the tiny tattoos in place of a shirt I'm not a fan of, and I really don't like the hairstyle. It looks like someone wanted the Paul Phoenix Tower but couldn't commit to the height. It looks better in the CG renders, so the problem was probably just the in-game model. His stage is the Silk Road Ruin. It's a fine stage, but I'm just not sure what it has to do with Hwang. Two Arcade Mode completions unlocks a new character, Yoshimitsu. Yoshimitsu is the sole survivor of the Manji clan. Oda Nobunaga once wanted the power of the clan on his side and invited the clan's chief to his castle. The chief was too old for the journey and sent Yoshimitsu, his strongest warrior, instead. The Manji preferred to be left alone in their hidden village, and so Yoshimitsu would decline Nobunaga's request for them to join him. Yoshimitsu would return to his village to find it destroyed. Nobunaga had an army all ready in case he was turned down and they had slaughtered the entire clan. Yoshimitsu tried to avenge them, but against the sheer size of Nobunaga's army, was defeated and lost an arm. Replacing his arm with a wooden prosthetic, while escaping through the caverns underneath his village, Yoshimitsu would recall the stories he'd heard of Soul Edge. Believing he could make Nobunaga and his followers pay with it, he sets out to find it. However, on hearing about Nightmare and seeing the destruction and suffering he caused with the sword, Yoshimitsu begins to have second thoughts. He truly wants to have his revenge, but he wonders if using a weapon like Soul Edge would leave him any better than his enemy. He wonders what would come after, and if the souls of his lost clan would even want him to go so far. Being brought over from Tekken, Yoshimitsu brings a lot of his moveset from that game with him. The spinning punches, the spinning kick, the pogoing and using his katana as a helicopter blade. Of course, since Soul Calibur characters have smaller movesets than Tekken characters, a lot of his hand-to-hand attacks were left behind. He also fills in a couple move slots with attacks borrowed from Mitsurugi. I had a blast with Yoshimitsu in this game. Usually with the size of his moveset in Tekken, I can never remember how to do most of his fun stuff. But Soul Calibur is a simpler game with smaller movesets, so it was easier to work things out and remember instead of constantly looking up the move list. It's especially fun when you set off a sword pogo at the right time and the AI just doesn't know how to deal with it. While Yoshimitsu has been a mainstay since this game, and Soul Calibur would become known for really kicking off the guest fighter trend in fighting games, his appearance here blew my mind as a kid. But it makes perfect sense. Yoshimitsu was famous for being the guy who used a weapon in Tekken, and it was known that his clan stretched back for hundreds of years. So putting an ancestor of his into Namco's weapon-based medieval set fighter is an obvious choice. I do like how he isn't an exact copy of his descendant's personality. Instead of being a Robin Hood figure yet, he starts as a man struggling with his desire for revenge and the lengths he'd go to achieve it. And I always did like the inclusion of historical figures like Nobunaga in the background. It's as if Soul Calibur is secretly happening in our real world history, and so its people and events will sometimes have consequences for the main cast. One thing I'm not a fan of is the costumes. Obviously, I don't expect crazy sci-fi stuff for this series, so going back to basics with samurai armor and an Oni mask like in Tekken 1 makes sense. But I just feel they picked the blandest possible colour scheme for him. His alternate has the opposite issue. I'm fine with the colours, but don't care for the outfit. I'm not big on the hat either, and I really hate the wooden texture on the mask and the rest of his body. He looks like he's been on the sunbeds too long and turned his skin to leather. His stage is the water labyrinth, a raft running down a river in a cave. I like this one with its blue lighting, and it works as a nice successor to Li Long's stage in Soul Blade. The third arcade mode completion grants us another newcomer, Lizard Man. Aeon Kalkos was another warrior chosen by Hephaestus, charged to destroy Soul Edge with a sacred sword and shield made by the god himself. However, unlike Sophitia, his quest didn't go as well. He got lost in a desert and was found collapsed and dehydrated by people from a nearby village. Thankful to the village for saving his life, Aeon vowed to repay them. However, the evil seed hit the village and Aeon would lose his mind and kill all of those that saved him. Kunpetku, Astaroth's creator, would hear of this and have Aeon captured. He performed several experiments on Aeon that would transform him into the Lizard Man. Now a slave to Kunpetku, he is once again sent out to find Soul Edge, only this time he has to bring it back to his owner. Lizard Man shares the majority of his moveset with Sophitia, with a few moves of his own to take advantage of his reptilian body. I enjoyed Sophitia, and so I enjoyed Lizard Man too. I like the addition of Lizard Man. The concept may seem a little generic, but I do think his presence adds to the roster by giving us the most monstrous looking character in the cast. It is interesting that Hephaestus sent out 24 warriors in Soul Blade though, one for each letter of the Greek alphabet. But that being said, if they were all granted similar swords and shields, we don't need to see the other 22 on the roster. What I also like about Aeon is that he shows that there were more than just the 10 Soul Blade characters doing things in that plot. Those were just the notable ones. There would have been several of us out there looking to take Soul Edge from Cervantes, and the ones who accomplished nothing and had to give up were the fortunate ones. There would have been many that died in the search, and then we have Lizard Man who got it worse from his failure. That said, he's not an absolute favourite. When he is on the roster, I'm happy to see him. When he isn't, I don't really notice at first, as there are other, lesser seen characters that I desire to see get a comeback. His default costume definitely is a Lizard Man. It's perfectly adequate, but a little generic. And every other costume he's ever had does more with the idea. The second costume is more like it, with all the fins they add to the back of his head. Just gives him a bit more character. His stage is the Kunpetku Shrine, a version of Astaroth's stage that swaps the lava with water to fit Lizard Man's character. It makes sense considering his role as Kunpetku's slave, but he also lacks his own theme music, having to share Astaroth's. Four arcade mode completions unlocks Yoshimitsu's Water Labyrinth as a freely selectable stage. Next we start getting some more returning characters, as completing arcade mode 5 times unlocks the original, uncorrupted Siegfried Staffen. I'm still a little confused as to whether this Siegfried's presence on the roster is canon or not. I've seen differing claims, but Nightmare's ending happened and Siegfried was free to be himself again for a while before becoming Nightmare again by Soul Calibur 2. But I've also seen claims that Siegfried stayed Nightmare throughout the entirety of the start of this game to the end of the next, so I don't know. He's a complete model swap of Nightmare with no changes, I believe. It makes sense, it was his moveset first and they are the same person in this game. So everything I had to say about Nightmare's gameplay applies here too. I remember being very happy to unlock Siegfried when I was a kid. He was the first character I gravitated to in Soul Blade, and with me not quite getting that he was Nightmare yet, I thought he'd been left behind. But then I unlock him, and he looked even cooler than he did before. The armour is less bulky, and the longer hair suits what his character has become. He's not some young, fresh-faced 16-year-old anymore. He's a mature and far more experienced 19-year-old. That's like tripling your age in fighting game years. I also love that he's voiced by Nobuyuki Hiyama, which means that he sounds exactly like Adult Link from Ocarina of Time when he fights. A neat coincidence considering the next game. His alternate costume is cool too, with a dark suit underneath and covered in the bits of black armour. His stage is nice, it's the City of Water. It's just Venice, and it makes a nice contrast to his stage as Nightmare. Said stage is unlocked for free use for 6 arcade mode completions. 7 completions unlocked Rock Adams. While Rock was searching for Soul Edge in the last game in the hopes it would help him regain his memories of his parents, he ran into Sophitia. Sophitia stopped their fight to ask him why he was hesitating, to which he realised that his search for Soul Edge had resulted in him leaving his adopted son Bango alone, and that by abandoning him, he may as well have never adopted him in the first place. So he returned home. 3 years later, Rock came home one day to find that Bangu was gone. Kunpeku had sent some mass-produced lizard men to kidnap Bangu to lure Rock to him so that his cult, Fegal Sestimus, could claim Rock's soul. So Rock has to embark on another journey to Europe to recover his son. Since Astaroth inherited a lot of Rock's moveset, it's not surprising that Rock here is a clone of Astaroth with some of his own things. The implication is that Kunpeku used Rock as the template to create Astaroth, which explains why they fight the same. Everything I said about Astaroth's gameplay applies here. As I've said, I much prefer Rock to Astaroth as I got older, and looking back, I'm so glad they didn't dump him from the roster for this game. He's so much more interesting than Astaroth. The huge guy who could crush your head with his bare hands, having his main motivation being his adopted son, and trying to work out how to be a good parent when he lost his own so young, is far more engaging to me than a big guy who wants to break people because he was told to. Sadly, much like Huang, this is also the beginning of the end for Rock as well. He'll appear more regularly than Huang, but he'll always come across more of an afterthought, as it's clear that the developers and the fanbase liked Astaroth more. But while Huang eventually came back, Rock has been removed from the series entirely with the two most recent games, with very little mention as to what happened to him. Although I believe part of that with the fans is that Rock was low tier a lot. As I said in the Soul Blade video, I'm not a competitive player, but I can say that Rock was garbage in his final mainline appearance. Maybe it's not the character people had a problem with, and if he was just more competitively viable, he'd have more fans. I really hope that if we get a Soul Calibur 7, that Rock can make his grand return. Like his primary costume in the last game, Rock wears animal skins, with his default having him wear an entire bullhead. It works in showing how powerful he is, but I prefer the bear skin he wears in Soul Blade for showing his face. The way it's modelled here makes it look like it's his actual head and Rock is a Minotaur. It's still a decent costume though. His alternate is him wearing a rhino skull, I think. I prefer this one as you can still see his jaw, and taking down a rhino with your bare hands is even more impressive than a bull, so it shows how powerful he is even better. Cue someone starting a bulls versus rhinos versus debate in the comments. His stage is a Colosseum, suitable for such a large and imposing fighter. A different one than the one in Soul Blade, I assume. It looks better, but the previous game's Colosseum had much better music to me. As did Rock himself. Not to insult his theme in this game, but his theme in Soul Blade is one of my favourite tracks in the series, so it's hard to top. Said stage is unlocked for 8 arcade mode completions. 9 completions unlock Song Mina. After running away from home in the first game, Huang found her and dragged her home. But more frustrations with her father trying to marry her off to Huang, and then one of his wealthy students built up, and she ran off once again to resume her search for Soul Edge. On the way, she ran into Ivy and picked a fight with her to prove she wasn't a child, only to end up suffering a humiliating defeat. Her confidence shattered, she ran into an alcoholic middle-aged man with a staff who she wound up in another fight with, only to not land a single hit. Unknown to her, that man was Kong Shu Chang, Shang Hua's father. She begged him to train her, and he did for over a year, teaching her the style he'd learned at the Ling Sheng Su Temple. A year later, he disappeared and left a note saying there was nothing more he could teach her. Mina would continue to train alone for a further 2 years until resuming her quest for Soul Edge. The part about Shu Chang in her story is there to explain why Song Mina now shares much of her moveset with Killik, but she still retains some Soul Blade moves. Mina tends to be considered the worst character in this game, and I get it. She can still be fun to play as, but she really is just bad Killik. Her attacks are slow and easily interrupted, and some just not seem to connect a lot of the time. But even then, this game's worst character is still enjoyable to me. It's nice to see them progress Mina and have her mature. She's still out to prove herself, but having her grow out of her impulsiveness after a single game is a good choice, as if she'd stayed like that in every game, it would be obnoxious, much like a certain character she'll be settled with after this game. Her first costume is an update on the idea of her Soul Blade outfit, losing the pink undershirt and making the top longer. I think it's an improvement, although she does look a bit like Julia from Tekken in this game. Her alternate is alright, but I don't have much to say about it. Kind of unremarkable. I couldn't tell you why Song Mina's stage is the Maze of the Dead, an underground labyrinth in Turkey. It's a fine stage, but what's she doing hanging out down there? Finally, with 10 arcade completions, I unlock Cervantes. Cervantes is always the opponent halfway through arcade mode at stage 5. He's actually a Dreamcast exclusive, he was not in the original arcade release of this game at all. After being killed by Taki and his reanimated corpse beaten up further by Siegfried, Cervantes is accidentally resurrected by Nightmare. This is thanks to Sophitia shattering one of Soul Edge's blades. She wasn't the only one riddled with shards, and said shards reacted to Nightmare and returned Cervantes to life. He'll spend the next 3 years on his ghost ship doing a bit of plundering while searching for Soul Edge. Despite knowing it would rob him of his free will once again, he wants it back. Cervantes keeps the Soul Blade moves you all remember, like his Psycho Crusher and the Rapid Stab In, and gains more. To make up for his loss of Soul Edge, one of his swords now has a gun built into the hilt. He was already really fun in that game, and he's just as fun here. Just don't Psycho Crusher yourself off the stage. It's curious that Cervantes wasn't included in the original version of the game and had to wait for a console port. Of course, he was killed in the last game, so it makes sense to leave him out and cycle in the next big villain. So it makes me wonder whether they either didn't have time to include him in the arcade, or if he was intended to sit the game out and was brought back due to either fan popularity, developer fondness, or just wanting to add more value to the Dreamcast port. Either way, I'm glad to see him. He hasn't been the main villain of the series since the first game, but he left such an impression that I still think of him as such. I will say though that Nightmare's existence does kind of hinder him story-wise. His main motivation for the next several games is to recover Soul Edge, but Nightmare is such an iconic and popular character that Cervantes cannot recover Soul Edge, as it would mean leaving Nightmare off the roster. So he does end up suffering from that issue other characters do when they've had the boss status and lost it. Some don't quite recover from that. The biggest addition to his story in this game is the reveal that he is Ivy's biological father, but it only becomes relevant to him in the next game. His first costume is a straight update of his Soul Blade costume, and it looks great. This style of dress works best on Cervantes, and I prefer him looking alive and human as opposed to what later games will go for. His second costume has him more armoured and wearing a mask. It's alright, better than his two alternate costumes from Soul Blade. The only thing is that the default is so good I never have any reason to use this one. His stage has his ship, the Adrian, docked outside a fortress. It's a nice stage with the sunset, and shows that Cervantes is still a threat, that he can take this entire fortress by himself. His theme music is like rocks in that it's good, but I just adore his theme from Soul Blade so much that my standards for a new Cervantes theme are too high. That's the 7 characters unlocked through clearing arcade with the default 10, now to finish it with these.
Out of the ring! Knockout! Knockout! Knockout!
Huang is injured during his fight with Inferno, only to be helped out by Soumina, who Huang admits he can rely on after her growth. As Huang sets back off to protect his country from invasion, he says that they don't need legendary weapons, they can do it themselves. Yoshimitsu chooses to destroy Soul Edge, but lightning from the sword struck his katana, leaving it cursed. Yoshimitsu abandons his quest for revenge and instead decides to help the poor. Word of his deeds spread and he attracts others who share his ideals. He becomes the first Yoshimitsu of the new Manji clan that continues into the modern day. Lizard Man is injured during his fight with Inferno, losing his last remaining shreds of sanity. He becomes a pure berserker, setting out to cause destruction and nothing else. His powerful roar would attract other monsters who would submit to him, and Lizard Man's new legion would begin their hunt. Siegfried returns to his hometown. Looking down at it from the cliff brings back memories of his childhood, his father, and his old band, the Schwarzwind. Said group, unaware of what happened to Siegfried over the last 3 years, welcome him back and ask where he went, not getting an answer. The band was thriving with old faces and new. Siegfried warns them of an impending monster attack and leads them into battle. Rock rescues Bangu and the two return to their home across the ocean. Bangu shows how he can lift Rock's massive axe and says that he'll be able to take care of himself now. Bangu would grow into a strong man himself and, as Rock once told him he would, sets off on his own quest to find his true soul. I really like how they keep setting up Bangu for a future next generation game. I can't wait to see when they do that so they can pay it all off. I'm sure it'll be great. Mina is about to collapse from exhaustion after defeating Inferno when Huang shows up to carry her home. As embarrassed as she is, she lacked the strength to fight back. But worse than embarrassment was returning home to another proposal from some ugly guy trying to buy her with 100 cattle. In the end, she considers running away a third time. Cervantes finally reclaims Soul Edge. The two become one and Cervantes once again emerges in the world through the flames of hell. The memories he'd lost from his resurrection return to him and he feels whole once again. Cervantes would become an even bigger terror on the seas once again, with even great navies having their fleets sank by him. Completing arcade mode with V7 unlocks one more, Edgemaster. Most of Edgemaster is unknown. his real name, past, and why he's named after a mode from the last game being things only he knows. He's old and skilled enough to be able to wield any weapon flawlessly. He was an advisor at the Ling Shengsu Temple, but would only come down from his mountain hut to take part in the ceremony where the sacred treasures would be passed to their next inheritors so that he could train them. But after the evil seed hit and Killik was the only survivor, he burned the temple down. After 3 years of teaching Killik to suppress the evil he held, he sends Killik out to destroy Soul Edge and purify himself. But once Killik left, he himself started to feel uneasy. He set off on his own quest. What for and his motivation, he keeps to himself. After Tekken introduced their first Mimic Fighter in Mokujin, Namco would follow up in this game with Edgemaster. Every round, Edgemaster will swap his moveset out for different characters. He makes sense as a guy who has mastered every weapon in the world because he's been training for so many years. I always like the Mimic Fighters, especially when they give a fitting lore reason for them to be so. Edgemaster is a fun one, but not my favourite. He's voiced by the late Daisuke Gori, who was great in every fighting game he was in, although this would be the only game in which he would get to voice him. It's also a lot of fun seeing this buff old guy performing animations that were just not made for him. Mimic Fighters have died off in the last decade, it seems. I haven't seen any since Tekken Tag Tournament 2 and Soul Calibur 5. I don't know if that's lack of use from players making it seem not worth the development time, or these much, much larger games can't handle the constant need to load in a new moveset every round. Either way, it's a shame. His default costume is pretty good for the kind of character he is. His head gives a Paimea vibe, but the buff chest and armour set him apart for an old man in these kinds of games. His second costume is interesting. Rather than the wise old master, we're shown some kind of hidden evil side. We don't learn anything more about it and it never appears again after this game, but it's an interesting hint to a past that we were never meant to see anything from. He shares Killik's stage and music, so let's finish this. Edgemaster returns from his journey to see that Killik is ready to take his final test. Edgemaster calls Killik over and jumps him in his evil form, telling him that one way to conquer the evil within yourself is to use evil itself. He then tells Killik to fight him off with everything he has. There's the 18 characters you can complete the game with using only arcade mode, and just based on that alone you can tell I had a great time. However, for the first time I'm covering one fighting game across two parts. Next time I will cover the game's mission mode, open up the gallery, and unlock all sorts of goodies, including the game's final unlockable character.